Hi everyone, my name is Annika. Thank you for logging on to this video today. Today I'm going to be walking us through a sample chem phys passage, and today's passage is going to be all about spectroscopy, which is a very interesting topic on the MCAT. So I hope that you guys will be able to learn something from this video and get some tips and tricks for how to tackle these similar questions if they ever happen to show up on your MCAT. So let's get started. Just before I start, I wanted to say that for chem phys passages, I normally like to spend about 8-ish minutes on each one, but today I'm going to be walking through it in detail and thinking out loud, so it'll take a little bit longer. Also, before we get started, my general strategy for these types of passages is to do one solid read through, pay attention to any key words or concepts that are kind of triggering my memory for key concepts I've learned about in my content review. I don't like to spend too much time on the figures right away, like parsing through all of their patterns and things like that, because I feel that with the questions, they'll force me to go back to them later. But yeah, with those things in mind, let's get started. So I'm going to start with the first paragraph, which reads, "The World Health Organization's list of essential medicines is a directory of medications that have been deemed by the scientific community to be vital for any health system. Among these medications are household medications such as acetaminophen. Acetaminophen is commonly used to treat fevers and pain." Okay, so not too many scientific concepts presented here. However, this is introducing us to the idea that this passage will likely be about acetaminophen and its structure. Okay, several studies are interested in determining the structure of acetaminophen using spectroscopy. Spectroscopy is a laboratory technique that uses electromagnetic radiation and its interactions with matter to determine key characteristics of compounds. This includes functional groups and the types of bonds present in a molecule. Two common spectroscopy techniques include infrared spectroscopy and nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. Okay, so this paragraph is really introducing us to a lot of the key concepts that hopefully are triggering some memories of when we went over them in content review. Keywords here are spectroscopy, I think, infrared and NMR. Infrared spectroscopy, I'm sort of starting to remember, is when you irradiate molecules with infrared light, and based on the different types of bonds and functional groups, they will absorb the light at different frequencies, and that will cause the bonds to vibrate and shake at or vibrate and stretch at certain points, and that can tell us what kinds of bonds are present. NMR spectroscopy kind of tells us similar things about the functional groups and the structure of the molecule, but the procedure is a little bit different. What we're doing is we're placing molecules into a magnetic field, and that magnetic field is causing chemical shifts in the nuclei of the atoms and the molecules between like their low optimal energy state, where that nucleus is magnetically aligned, and its high non-optimal unstable energy state, where the nuclei are not magnetically aligned. So those are kind of the main ideas that are like coming to memory as I'm reading this passage. Okay, as we keep going, first the students took a sample of acetaminophen and irradiated it with infrared light. A spectrometer was used to detect the frequencies at which absorption occurred. The resulting data is shown in figure one. Okay, so figure one, just at my first read through, I'm not going to figure out like all the nuances of the graph, but I'm just kind of trying to figure out what it's telling me. So on the x-axis, we have something called wave number in the units of inverse centimeters. And so this is telling me that this is going to be some kind of proxy of light frequency. So we have a range from 4,000 to 500. And this is basically telling us the range of essentially frequencies of light that are being shot at or irradiated at this molecule. On the y-axis, we have something called transmittance, which is in the units of percent transmittance. And so the key thing here is that what we're actually looking for to be interesting in the graph is when there's not 100% transmittance, because for IR spectra, when you shoot IR light at the molecule, if 100% of the light is being transmitted through, that means nothing really interesting is happening. No bond is absorbing the light at that point. So what we're actually looking for are the places where there is low transmittance, because at low transmittance means high absorption. And at those points, the bonds of the molecules are absorbing light for whatever reason. Okay, so I see some points in the graph where there are dips, and that means there's not 100% transmittance. I'm not going to spend too much time thinking about those, but which is interesting to note. Okay, next, the students took a sample of the drug and subjected it to NMR spectroscopy. The data from this procedure is shown in figure 2. Okay, so here we have figure 2. We're looking at an NMR spectra now. This looks a little bit different from IR spectra, that there is no y-axis, there's just an x-axis that's telling us chemical shift, and we have a range from 10 to 0. And we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different peaks here. All of them are singlet peaks, that's what I'm noticing. Just some terminology for reading these spectra. If we're going left, if we're looking like the leftmost parts of the spectra, that's called downfield. The rightmost parts are called upfield. We'll talk more about that later, but basically I'm seeing that we have four peaks kind of clustered more downfield, and then we have one that's like more upfield. And that's all I want to be paying attention to right now. So overall, I feel like we have a good understanding of the passage. We've used spectroscopy on this molecule, two different types, and now let's get into the questions to see what they're asking. Okay, number one, which of the following is the range for the fingerprint region of an IR spectrum? Okay, so we're looking for a fingerprint region. So for this question, it might be difficult if you don't know what a fingerprint region is, but let's sort of think through what that means. As humans, we all have unique fingerprints, and similarly for molecules in their IR spectra, they have these fingerprint regions that are different for every single molecule. So we're looking for the place in the spectra that is completely unique for any molecule of interest. If we look at the spectra, we know that different like dips in the transmittance represent different functional groups, and those functional groups can be in any molecules, right? Like tons of different molecules have carbonyls, tons of different molecules have OH groups. Those are not necessarily going to be completely unique for every single molecule, but what is unique for every single molecule is this region out here. This is called the fingerprint region, where we have a bunch of like not as defined like peaks and dips. They're kind of all clustered together, and these are going to be different for every single molecule. If we look at where this is in the spectra, we see that it starts kind of in the middle right here of the 1 in 2000, which is about like 1500, and it ends when the spectra ends, which is about 500. And looking at the answer choices, letter choice C corresponds best to that region. Okay, number two, the broad peak around 3000 inverse centimeters found in figure 1 indicates the presence of which functional group? Okay, so for the purposes of today, I'm going to be revealing a table that I think is going to be very useful for these kinds of questions, and I recommend that for you guys in your studying, to make an effort to sort of acquaint yourself with this table and maybe memorize some of these key features, because this is fair game for the test. So on this table, we see four main functional groups and their signatures on these IR spectra. So we have carbonyls, carboxylic acids, amines, and hydroxyl groups, and how they show up on the spectra. So the broad peak in question is this one right here. And if we look at the table, this is hopefully something we're going to commit to memory for the MCAT. We see that the broad peak at around 3300, which is close enough to 3000, corresponds to an OH group. So now we want to look at the answer choices and figure out which one of these has an OH group in it. Carbonyls do not. That's a C double bonded to an O. Carboxylic acids do have an OH group, but they also have a carbonyl. Alcohols are simply just OH groups, and then amino groups have nitrogens in them. So based on this, I think the best answer is going to be alcohols, because those are just purely OH groups. If we look at this table, we see that carboxylic acids actually have their own signature. They have broad peaks at 3000 and 1750. And when we look at our spectra, we only see a peak at a peak, meaning like a dip in transmittance. We only see that at 3000. So that's going to be indicative of an alcohol. Okay, number three. Which of the following statements most accurately characterizes NMR spectroscopy? So we talked about it a little bit as I was going through the passage, but let's look at the answer choices and see which one fits best. Okay, letter choice A. It uses a magnetic field to measure the mass of each individual atom in a compound. Okay, I like the word magnetic field because that is the core of NMR spectroscopy. However, are we really looking at mass for spectroscopy? The answer is no. Spectroscopy tells us, as was said in the passage, about functional groups and bonds. It does not tell us about the mass of each individual atom in a compound. So A is not necessarily the best answer. Let's look at answer choice B. It uses a magnetic field, again, I like that, to manipulate the alignment of atomic nuclei. That is true. It does manipulate the alignment of atomic nuclei. Like I said, it's measuring these shifts between the misaligned and the aligned atomic nuclei. So this is a compelling answer choice. Let's just look at C and D for good measure. Okay. It allows researchers to determine key functional groups. Okay, that's good. That's true about spectroscopy, but not the overall structure of a molecule. This is actually false. NMR spectroscopy does tell us about nearby functional groups and sort of the connectivity of different atoms in a molecule. And so that is telling of overall structure. So because of that, I'm going to eliminate answer choice C, because the first part of this sounds good, but the second part is not necessarily true. Okay, and lastly, it separates molecules based on their charge. Okay, in spectroscopy, a key thing to note is that we are not separating anything. We have tons of other methods we need to know for the MCAT about separation. Spectroscopy is not one of them. This is basically just using light to determine the structure of a molecule. We're not separating anything. And so I'm going to eliminate answer choice D, and we're going to go with B. Okay, number four. Which of the following functional groups is most likely to generate the furthest downfield chemical shift in figure two? Okay, so like we talked about earlier, downfield is going to be really far to the left of the spectra. And the furthest downfield peak that we see here is this one. And it looks like it's around, it's between 8 and 10. Looks like it's between 9 and 10, actually, this peak. So we want to be looking at which of these answer choices will correspond to a peak between like 9 and 10-ish. Just before we look at the answer choices, I'm going to think in my head about what a downfield shift means. And a key to this is thinking about electron donating and electron withdrawing groups. So just conceptually, if an atom is near an electron withdrawing group, that means the electron withdrawing group is very, very electronegative, and it's kind of pulling the electrons away from the nucleus of that atom. By pulling the electrons away, it's deshielding that nucleus, and it's making it more susceptible to the magnetic field, which will lead to a greater downfield shift. On the flip side, if we have an electron donating group nearby, that electron donating group will kind of push the electrons towards the nucleus of that atom, and those electrons will be involved in shielding and kind of protecting that nucleus from the magnetic field, which will not cause as much of a chemical shift. So that will be an upfield signal. So if we're looking for something that causes the furthest downfield signal, that means that the nucleus has become incredibly susceptible to the magnetic field to create this huge shift, which probably means there's an electron withdrawing group nearby that's deshielding that nucleus. So right off the bat, I know I'm going to kind of want to be thinking about an answer choice that has an electron withdrawing group or a very electronegative group nearby. Okay, for the purposes of today, I'm going to again reveal a table that is going to be very useful in being able to answer these types of questions, and hopefully we can all be acquainted with this before we take the MCAT to help us with these. But if we look at these answer choices, TMS is kind of like a base standard, you want to think of it as. It actually causes no chemical shift, and so this we should eliminate right off the bat, because TMS would be creating a peak right here at the very beginning. Like a very, very upfield peak, not going to be downfield at all. SP3 hybridized carbon. Okay, if we look at where that is on the table, we see that it will create a chemical shift of about 0 to 2. Looking at where that is on the spectra, that's pretty upfield. That's probably this peak, but not necessarily the one we want. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate that one. Carboxylic acid. Okay, carboxylic acids we know have carbonyls and OH groups. Those are very much electronegative things, electron withdrawing groups. So that will probably cause some kind of downfield signal. If we look at our table, which is something we'll hope to memorize, we notice that this creates a shift of 10 to 13. And we can look at the spectra and say, oh wait, there's nothing from 10 to 13. That part's not actually even shown. That's a little bit too downfield for our molecule. So carboxylic acids are probably not going to be in our molecule, so we're going to go ahead and eliminate that. Next, we can look at aldehydes, which also have an electron withdrawing group in the form of a C double bonded to an O. If we look at our table, we see that that creates a shift of about 9 to 10, which is perfect. That's exactly what we're looking at right here. And so that's going to be our answer. Okay, finally, number 5, based on the information in the passage, which of the following is most likely not found in a pseudogiffin? Okay, so again, this table is going to be very useful for us. We can start by looking at answer choice A, aromatic carbons. So aromatic carbons show up around 6 to 9 on the spectra. If we look at our table, or if we look at our spectra, we definitely see peaks in the 6 to 9 range. So we probably do have aromatic carbons in there. This is not enough to say that we don't have them. So we can go ahead and eliminate A. SP2 hybridized carbons. Okay, we just said that there were probably aromatic carbons in our molecule. And let's think about the hybridization of aromatic carbons. Those are carbons that are double bonded at one or at on one side and single bonded on the other, and then bonded to a hydrogen. That is an SP2 hybridization. So aromatic carbons are SP2 hybridized carbons. Those are the same thing. So we can go ahead and eliminate answer choice B as well. Okay, alcohols. So we don't really see anything about alcohols in our NMR table, which is fine, because if we look back at what we said for number 2, and we look back at our IR spectra, we already concluded that there was an alcohol group in our molecule because of the broad peak at around 3,000 was indicative of an alcohol. So this is where we have to use both the spectra to sort of answer this question. We already decided there was an alcohol, and we talked about that for number 2, so let's go ahead and eliminate that. Carboxylic acids, we kind of talked about this in question 4, how they created a downfield shift so far of 10 to 13 that we didn't see in our spectra. So we can conclusively say that there's not a carboxylic acid probably in our molecule. Okay, overall, I hope this was super helpful for you guys in walking through this passage and learning a little bit more about spectroscopy. Feel free to email me with any questions you may have if you had questions about how I answered some of these or how I worked through this passage. Hope this was useful, and happy studying.